Again, there's been a political storm, church storm. Sustainability by someone else is going to pay for this good idea forever. I think we do the same thing to the diocese, whoever the diocese is, that we do to our rectors. We walk into a rector's office and we say, here's a great idea. You find the money for it, and then you do it. Find someone else to do it. And the rector ought to be like, wait, what? This was your idea. I thought you were going to do it. And then the person replies, oh, I don't have time to do this. There are such things as bad ideas. Bad ideas are your good ideas that you have someone else to pay for. Today, I see people taking amazing ministry steps, and so many of us, many of you in this room, many of our church members have gone to the mission bug, to the service and evangelism. In 2012, we had a couple of missional communities. I'm pretty sure y'all thought I was crazy when I offered the suggestion that we could go out and start these things, but today we have 88 missional communities gathering outside the church buildings. 45 congregations. 780 new people are touched by this mission initiative. Two of them we just made into mission churches of this council. Missions of the Diocese in 2018, we supported existing congregations in planting missional communities with over $390,000. You all are doing amazing creative work by walking out your doors and building new congregational growth in 2018, we planted 3 more congregations. We are now together supporting 12 church plants, 10 since 2012, serving over 730 new Episcopalians. We are supporting this program with about $5 million a year. We also have 3 second site congregations that have expanded existing ministry in Georgetown, Austin, and Tyler. And in 2019, we will plant 3 more congregations. We're beginning to think about who will go pray for who is to represent Jesus' love and tend God's sheep out into these new areas. What's interesting is another homecoming is happening. We're also in conversations with 3 non-Episcopal churches who serve over 400 people. They want to become Episcopalians. It is a different thing. It is one thing to try and convince ourselves that we're healthy and well, but when fish are jumping in your boat, it's a sign of some good work, I'm telling you. Now let's think for a moment about how we're working together for existing congregations. Not every congregation has financial resources to support its mission, though it has substantial mission opportunity. These would be congregations like Lord of the Streets, a particularly unique homeless and working poor community in Midtown. Or perhaps a congregation in which we have many serving in economically depressed areas or cities. We support these efforts with $1 million a year in grant funding, and these congregations serve over 2,000 any given week without us finding to have congregations to go to. We also support existing congregations in other ways. Certainly, we are out on the road. Our mission and team together go over 70,000 miles on their cars, I guess, getting out in the field, supporting you all, meeting and visiting and coaching. We also support, though, we also bring dollars to that work, to existing congregations, about $200,000 a year for congregational aid and ministry. $500,000 in emergency need, that's not included in our hurricane work. $50,000 in redevelopment grants. $80,000 in programs, small conferences, and support for existing congregations. $100,000 in moving expenses for projects put off for over 20 or more years. We're helping existing congregations improve their mission potential, and we did that with an additional $7.5 million. Those dollars follow growth, exponential growth by those congregations, and intentional evangelism and outreach into the community. They follow service. The dollars don't come first. We also use our funding stream to help in times of crisis, and we do this every year with our aid, recently with Harvey in particular. We ask to support congregations for a short time during the recovery. We help clergy pensions. We also help with shortfall in dollars, and then there was a lot of reconstruction and construction to do. In 2018, we made sure that 31 congregations would not go underwater with $3.4 million in advance. Some of those are massive rebuilds, and some of them have not even started. We're also supporting our clergy. While we underwrite for the diocese, the majority of the cost of health care is around $5 million. We spent an additional $400,000 for clergy support and salaries to new priests. We spent $150,000 to train bivocational clergy at our annual program. $150,000 in sabbatical grants to help clergy stay healthy, and another $150,000 for families and programming. We're supporting clergy and their families through wellness and care, providing an underwriting clergy spouse retreat and clergy family retreat, plus programming for clergy to help them along with their leadership, become healthy, and thrive in ministry. A few of you have asked how much we support our own outreach ministries, like Elwin's Marathon or St. Vincent's House, Camp Allen. We supported those ministries with over $6 million in grants, of which about $1.3 million went directly to ministries to the poor and those in need. And some of that goes to parishes that are doing work with homeless ministries and working poor like Echoes from a community in Houston. We gave another $380,000 to community-based ministries outside the Episcopal Church that connected to our churches. And then, thanks to the work of the Board of Episcopal Health Foundation and their staff, we helped our communities to strive towards wellness with another $23 million in funding to community-based organizations all over our diocese. Elaine and Mark will talk to us a little bit more about that work at our council. In our goals, we said that we wish to be part of the communion and wider church. I serve as the president of the Compass Rose Society, and there are many members of that society in our diocese. We support global mission and host a general convention. We're going to have some awards tomorrow for that. We have grants to the Episcopal Church and the Anglican Communion for over $3.3 million. Those dollars went to everything from Jerusalem support and the church there to North Dakota and Costa Rica. And in India, we helped with a gift to train about 8 women to be nurses. We're helping bring cancer treatment to the Gaza Strip and informing leaders all over the world. still a major issue, though. We just approved a large number of hospitals. Last year, though, I became concerned. So I invited 25 people from every part of the diocese to come together. And they work in pondering how much information we need, how do we form leaders and apostles to go out, how do our structures work regarding discernment for holy orders, what processes get in the way, and how can we speed up when we want to and slow down when we need to. How are we looking at programs globally and across the Episcopal Church to bring in the best practices that we can learn? We're seeking to understand new kinds of leadership that are needed in paid and unpaid models, and what's working now and what can work better. Part of that is that we want to be intentional for the personalized approach. Intentional, contextual, and innovative development. Intentional discernment models, creating intentional formation and education for both the baptized and the clergy. And we have to look at funding approaches. What is the real cost for formation? The real cost for supporting those in training, scholarships, insurance. So we're studying our matrix of transitions and what kinds of clergy that we actually need in the diocese. We hope to identify how best to provide effective care, support the clergy at each point of transition in the vocational process that we have. And as we look at that, it is clear that we need to raise a fund to help the vocations for the baptized and the clergy. Moreover, given the continued rise of healthcare costs, coupled with our desire to create a community of healthy clergy and lay employees, we will have to do something more than what we're presently doing regarding insurance. Both the cost of leadership development and healthcare for our leadership may have ordained have outpaced our capacity, which seems so over the top just a few years ago. So I want you to know that I'm presently working with a very small group of key leaders on bringing solutions forward for these two ideas. And I hope to have an announcement in 2020 as we take our next steps together on how we might deal with these two new funds and sustain them in perpetuity. What is amazing to me, though, as I think of all of this, really isn't the work that your diocese and staff is doing, that is quite remarkable. Instead, it's the work that you are doing. You are actually out there changing the church, changing your churches, changing the world, and sharing the gospel. You are faithful. You are completely hard. You strive, and you push. The story care deeply for the pastoral care of your people. It is easy to be anxious. But has it ever really been different? Has it ever really been different for Christians and for their mission? From the prophets of old to the disciples and the first followers of Jesus, did they not have trials and tribulations that brought them to depend deeper and greater upon the Lord their God? Is that not what they learned from that time? We have been a community united with the cause of Christ, and this age is no different. This moment in our context, what is before us, is no different, because God has not abandoned us. We have not lost our faith. We have Jesus Christ with us, and God's Spirit lighting our way like a pillar in the wilderness. And we are nothing less than being invited to be a part of God's story. How miraculous is that, that God would choose us to take up the banner at this time and to proclaim the gospel. And we are a unique breed of Christians. We are Texas Episcopalian, and we will rise to the challenge. We will rise to the challenge just as those four laity and free clergy and Bishop George Washington Freeman did when they set out on their own with their own dollars in their pocket, and they walked through the mud and muck of a winter January day 170 years ago to hold the first council in the Diocese of Texas. We will do this together. Last night, in closing, I just want to say, last night I was really struck when Bishop Harrison spoke. Said that she loved you, and then that she felt your love for her. What an amazing thing it is to be a guy.